Everybody smile at me. You know, I haven't seen your smiling faces in a little over a week. Just smile at me if you didn't brush them. That's all right. You're kind of under the dim light, so it doesn't matter if you didn't brush them. I really can't tell if they're green or yellow today. Anyway, just smile at me. Hold it. Let me just get around the room. Can I just tell you, I talked a lot about you in Colombia. You say, oh, Lord, I sure did. I told those folks there that I believe that I had some of the best people in the entire world at Healing Waters Worship Center. And I believe that. I told pastors that I had the privilege to lead over there. That's a lot of pressure when you're the team lead and you got guys that have never been on missions trips before and you have to kind of walk them through the do's and don'ts. And it's really funny when you forget to tell them some of the do's and don'ts, and they do what they were supposed to not do. They do. It's just great stuff. It's just great fun. Don't eat the little red things. They're actually very hot. It's not a berry. Whoops, forgot to tell them. And instead, it was more like, oh, look at the fruit. Good stuff. Good times. Praise God. But we had a good time. Amen. We want to continue to worship the Lord this morning in our giving, if our ushers would come. As we just worship the Lord together in our... I had the privilege of standing in one of the largest churches of Colombia. It's actually, the pastor is one of the main congressmen for the entire country. I had the privilege of speaking into his life and sharing with him and his family. And I noticed something that, as you know, when we get ready to give, we celebrate. You know what they do at his church? When they get ready to give, people get up and literally start clapping. They start dancing. They get so excited about being able to give to God. And I just kind of caught me by surprise. People got up and started dancing, and I was like, and of course I said, well, all right. He says, Kay, which is what? You know, he said, what? And I just waved at him, you know. The translator was caught up at the moment, and it was just a wonderful, wonderful time. And I told him how much I appreciated seeing the folks there excited about being in partnership together as well, and especially in an area and in a place where they don't quite have what we have, but they're excited about who God's called them to be together, and they're making a difference. They're also making a difference in their country. The congressman shared with me that it's his prayer that their country get more Christian congressmen because they want to change the course of Colombia. And so that was just an honor to be able to stand in that man's pulpit and minister to him and to his family. And just awesome stuff. Let's pray together this morning as we prepare to give to the Lord. Father, thank you for this privilege that we have to bring to you your tithe and our offering. Lord, what an honor it is to come before you this way. I ask you, Lord, that you would receive the gifts that we bring and utilize it, I pray, to the furthering of your kingdom. Lord, thank you for what you've been doing in our lives at Healing Waters. Thank you for what you're going to continue to do as we partner together. And Father, help us to never get our eyes off of who you are. Help us to never get our eyes fixated on people or places or things, but to keep our eyes fixed upon you. For you are the author and the finisher of our faith. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you this morning as you give to the Lord.
There's a peace I've come to know. Oh, my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead.
Aren't you glad he's risen from the dead? Amen. I had some wonderful moments of ministry while in Colombia. One of the things that took place prior to me leaving, something I just kind of held to myself, shared with no one. Prior to leaving, the Lord had spoke to my heart and told me that I was going to meet a person in Colombia named Maria and that I was to confirm her calling into the ministry. I didn't say anything about it and thought, whew, you know, that's pretty significant. And when I got to the congressman's church, they introduced me to my translator. They said, this is her first time ever translating. And as a matter of fact, she's kind of wrestling with her call to ministry. And I said, really? What's her name? They said, we'd like for you to meet Maria. We stepped onto the platform, and as I began to speak, the presence of the Lord just very strongly came to that large auditorium, and she began to tremble, and she began to cry to where she was having a hard time translating. And I put my hand on her back, and I said, that's the presence of the Lord. That's His anointing. You take a few deep breaths, because when you're called, this is what you have to stand under when you minister, and you can't fall apart. You have to be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. And at the end of the message, I shared with the congregation the significance of what was taking place. And I heard someone just bellowing and weeping to my right, to the right side. It was her mother. And her mother had been praying that somehow God confirmed to her daughter that she was called into the ministry. And I told her in front of that large auditorium, I said, isn't it interesting that God would send a crazy white man over 2,400 miles? Now, why did they laugh at that? I said, isn't that interesting? Let's try that again. No, I was kidding. I said, isn't that interesting that God would send a crazy white man? I said, gringos locos, and crazy white man. But I said, isn't that something that God would send a crazy white man that many miles just for you? And they just begin to cry. And it was just, we had some significant, significant moments of ministry. How many of you guys got the email I sent this last week? Had some significant moments in my own life. For the last good while, it seems like I've been going through some stuff physically a lot. Many of you know about the car accident. We're still trying to figure stuff out with that. Got a call from when I was in Columbia. I called and found out because of the accident, it did something again to my shoulder. Now the rotator cuff is actually torn, and there's another bone impingement because of the accident. Now I'm going to have shoulder surgery again, which I'm really not happy about. But I had a pastor that was there that we were trying to pray and minister to people. I'll get to what I'm going to share with you in just a few minutes. But we were trying to minister to people, and he kept coming over and hit me on the back. I kept thinking, you know, I'm praying for people. He keeps slapping me. I mean, right here, you know, and that's kind of danger area, you know. I taught the pastors there, don't touch people down that area. It could give you the wrong impression. He's walking by, and he's tapping me, and I keep going. And I'm up there praying for people, and I finally turned around, and they began to talk to me, and they just kind of crowded around me, and they began to talk to me, and the pastor looked at me, and he said, the Lord told me to tell you something, and of course, I'm like, uh-oh. He said, 22 months ago, he said, Satan asked God that he could kill you. He said, and you've had physical problems for 22 months. He said, but God said you could not be killed because of the purpose he had for you, but that the enemy could try to weary the body so that God could elevate a man. And I was just standing there, and I was crying so hard because you don't know the half of the physical things of the last 22 months that has hit. And I just was, that was another God moment. There were several significant just God moments over in Columbia that were just significant. That was just one that was kind of for me personally. And one of the reasons I'm really thankful to be home is our last day we were on the streets of Bogota. And we were walking on the streets of Bogota, and evidently there was a riot at the university. Thousands of students took to the streets with bricks, bottles, and stones. And they were hurling those bricks, bottles, and stones, and we're walking down the street, and we get to a point where we're like, oh, I mean, there's this mob of people rushing, and the police come out, and they've got their shields up, and they're shooting shotguns with rubber bullets into this crowd. And they're starting, and we've got bricks and bottles that are landing all around us, just busting on the pavement. And they start shooting. I mean, this happened in just a few moments. And the police began to shoot these little cannons of tear gas into the crowd, or what we thought was tear gas. And the wind shifted. Well, when the wind shifted, it hit my group of pastors. And I've never in my life experienced, our nose started to burn, our throats began to burn, our lungs began to burn, our faces began to burn. We had no idea what, and we just took off running blindly down the streets of Bogota. And but thank God for His grace. You know, we, about 40 minutes later, the fog lifted, and we had to figure out kind of where we were at. But it was an amazing, amazing moment. They told me, they said, man, don't go home and share that. I said, why? They said, your people will chain you to that place and never let you go over there again. And I said, no, it has nothing to do with that. I said, that's just a testimony of God's grace and how you can have bricks and bottles and things breaking all around you, but it shall not come near your dwelling place. So it's just the scriptures lived in our lives. So I'm grateful to be home. Let's go very quickly to Luke chapter 17. I want to also tell you, the church I went to that was the congressman's church, they told me, they said, well, you got the earliest service, so you know, your folks will be here to pick you up first. I said, okay, that'd be great. What time service? They said, it starts at 9 o'clock. I said, oh, okay, they got an early service. They get out, you know, pretty quick. Oh, no. We started at 9 a.m. And for some of you to say, man, pastor just keeps us long. They sing too long. They do all this. Here's what was pretty cool. They sang for an hour and 49 minutes. Thought to myself, and we complain? And here's what this is what was really cool. You saw people standing up for a few minutes, and then they'd sit down. They'd stay in a posture of worship. Then they'd stand back up. They'd clap, they'd worship, they'd sit right back down. And I was like, this is great. I wish I'd taken a video of it. We didn't get out of church till 1:30, and we began at 9 o'clock. The congressman told me, he says, take as much time as you want. We said in Spanish, and they translated. I said, all right. And I didn't take too terribly long. But we have a very awesome privilege of worshiping the Lord together as a body. And oftentimes that's clouded by a lot of things that I really want to talk to you about today. And I want to ask you a question today. Are you living a thank-filled life? Luke chapter 17, we're going to start in verse 11, but as you're turning there, how many of you have ever met somebody that was ungrateful? How many of you really enjoyed being around ungrateful people? Ungrateful people sometimes irritate you, don't they? How about an unthankful attitude? But guys, we're living in a day and time where we have a danger lurking, I believe, in every home and every relationship and every workplace and every church. And the danger is simply unthankful attitudes that transcend into a lot of other things that I want to talk to you about this morning. Luke chapter 17, beginning verse 11. Now it happened. Say it happened. As he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, and they stood afar off. They lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Did you notice they're worshiping here? You see that? They called him by name, and then they identified him with something else. They said, Jesus, Master. Well, the word master there is a worshipful expression. They said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So when he saw them, he said to them, go show yourselves to the priest. So it was that as they went, they were cleansed. But one of them, when he saw he was healed, returned and with a loud voice, look at your neighbor and say, a loud voice. Do they have to really be that loud in church? They returned to the Lord with a loud voice. This one did. And fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. That's important to note. So Jesus answered and said, were not the 10 cleansed? But where are the nine? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner? And he said to him, arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well. Father, for the next few moments, add your blessing to your word. Help us, Lord, to understand that we have to have a thanks-living life. Because if we're not thanks-living, we will never be thanksgiving. And if we're not living in thanksgiving, then we'll actually start to become stagnated, critical, and full of all kinds of things that you never intended for us to have individually, maritally, parentally, or any other way. Help us today through your word, and we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. This area of a thank-filled life is really nothing new. I mean, if we go all the way back to the children of Israel when they come out of Egypt, the Bible says that when they leave Egypt, that there are none sick or feeble among them. That's pretty powerful. So God delivers them and he brings them out. I want you to just imagine this for Israel. When they come out, there's a pillar of a cloud by day that blocks the sun. So they're able to walk and not be burned and hurt by the sun. And then at night, in order for them to be able to see, there's a pillar of fire that just comes down from the sky. And God is just there in power. And they complain. I want to tell you the first sign of an unthankful person or a thankless life is complaint. And they immediately begin to complain. Oh, you brought us out here to die. We want to go back to Egypt where we had meat and all these other things. It's nothing new. And God would meet the need. They would complain, we're thirsty, God. You don't love us anymore. Moses would strike a rock at Meribah Kadesh and water would flow. And they would sit there at the water, oh, this water's so good. Ah, we don't have any meat. We're going to die. God would send them manna and they would gather the manna and they would say, oh, this is so good. But we don't have any quail. We're going to die. Stuff was never good enough. Here's what's amazing. When God led them out of Israel, it was less than 8 days' journey to the promised land. 40 years and a generation pass, and they still hadn't gotten there. 8 days they were circumvented by an unthankful mindset, thankless living. So this is nothing new. And then we come to the New Testament. 10 lepers that the Bible says are standing afar off. Jesus sees them. No doubt they've heard of the miracles that Jesus can perform. They know of his miracles. They know just, man, this guy, when he speaks, man, things have to change. They're standing afar off, and Jesus looks at them. And you got to notice that Jesus goes through Samaria and Galilee. These lepers that are there, the only common bond they have is their sickness. Because in the leper colony, if you will, the 10, you had Galileans, Samaritans, and Judeans. So you had a mixture. And so Jesus looks at them and he says, go show yourself to the priest. Now here's what that meant for them. There was only one individual that was able to put them back in society, if you will. And that was the priest in the temple. But there were certain rituals that they would have to go through for several days, perhaps even weeks, proving that they had been cleansed from leprosy. Now, what is leprosy? Well, if you simply study leprosy, a lot of people think that leprosy is just where your hands fall off. Well, no, that's really not what it is. Leprosy is a severe circulatory and nerve disease that actually affects the entire immune system, that would actually cause the body to be susceptible to other diseases that could cause you to lose a limb or a part of your body. It would also be in such a way that you would lose feeling in your extremities. You could become blind. A lot of times there would be knots and webs that would well up on a person that would contort and change their shape because it was almost like an arthritic type response to the body. There would be nodules and knots, and they would kind of contort and not look like a normal person anymore because they had gotten leprosy. Many times when lepers would lose their limb, it was because they were out doing something and they hit the part of the body that was numb and they failed to realize they did it, and they got a disease that caused gangrene, and the piece of the body had to be separated, whether it was a finger, a hand, a toe, a foot, or so on and so forth like that. It wasn't just that, boom, they got leprosy and their hand fell off. Okay? That's kind of like a myth sometimes preachers say, well, somebody got leprosy and their arm fell off. Well, that's not really how it happens. But leprosy begins as a small crimson stain, like a little dot on an extremity. And if it's not dealt with, it begins to spread and it turns white. Almost comes like a rough texture to the skin where it begins on the body, and it begins to continue to grow. And if it's not dealt with or healed, it actually begins to attack the nervous and the circulatory system. And so when it gets full blown, it just affects the entire body. The Lord said through the prophet Isaiah, he said, come, let us reason together. Though your sin is as scarlet, it shall become white as snow, as even like wool. And preachers have preached that passage for years. I said, oh, come to know Jesus and he'll make your sin white as snow. Because this is what the scripture, that's not what the scripture's meaning. The Lord speaking through the prophet to the nation, he says, listen, right now your sins are scarlet. There's a little crimson stain on your extremity right now. Come, let us reason together. Right now, it's a little crimson stain. But if we don't deal with it, it's going to spread and become white like wool, as white as snow. The Lord is speaking through the prophet to the nation of Israel, telling them to beware of the dots on their extremities, where they feel, where they express, because what's going to happen if they don't get it fixed, it's going to cause an attack of the entire central nervous system of the body, and they are literally going to be stranded on this earth because they didn't listen to what God was saying to them. Well, how does that apply to us, Pastor? Glad you asked. I believe that there's a portion of leprosy that has hit the church in America that's this unthankful attitude. Where, I mean, could you imagine having physical leprosy? How many of you ever woke up and your hand's numb? One of the weirdest feelings, my first shoulder surgery, they hit me on the neck with, no, they didn't hit me on the neck. They stuck a needle in my neck, and they numbed my right arm. And I'm going to tell you what, when I got home, I mean, it just, you didn't even feel from here down. And so I would take my arm, and I was like, that's the weirdest feeling. You feel it hit your leg, and you're like, where did that come from? You know, you have no feeling. It's a horrible feeling to have no feeling. And that's what leprosy does, and that's what a thankless life does to us. It causes us to have no feeling. It causes us to look down our nose at other people. It causes us to respond in the wrong way. Do you realize that if we do not have thanksgiving or thanksgiving in our life, we can actually contract a critical spirit that transfers with our friends. It goes into our workplace. It goes into our nation. It even goes in the church against people, against pastors, and all these kind of things, because we get into a place where we're just not thankful. I figured at least that we'd be a little charged up this morning because we're getting ready to enter Thanksgiving. But you know what? Here's the deal. When we're not thank-filled properly, everything kind of falls apart. When we focus on all the wrong things, it kind of messes us up. How many of you have ever focused on the wrong things? You got my video ready? Okay. You ever focused on the wrong things? Have you ever focused on the wrong thing and didn't know you were focusing on the wrong thing until somebody snapped you into it and you were like, oh. And then tried to be like, oh, yeah, well, I knew that. That's what I kind of meant. You ever been there and done that? Let me show you a couple of guys that had that experience. Watch the screen just for about 60 seconds.
Ugh. You know, I am so thankful for my car. I love my car.
Yep.
Mm, and I'm thankful for Twinkies. I love Twinkies.
Yep.
And I'm thankful for TiVo. That changed my life.
Yep.
And I'm thankful that I don't live in a third world country. Boo.
Yep.
Thankful for my gym membership. I mean, look at me.
Yep.
What do you think about Warren?
I'm thankful that Jesus died on the cross for my sins so I wouldn't have to spend eternity in hell. That's about it.
I was gonna say that. I just didn't know we were talking about spiritual stuff.
Yep.
If you notice one of the things he said, I didn't know you were talking about spiritual stuff. Can I tell you something? You can't separate it as a believer. The very thing that we should be living and thriving from is cast to the wayside as we're consumed by all these things that really don't matter. Say this with me, temporary. We get so caught up in the temporary that it shapes the permanent in our life. And when we become a thankless society, we actually become like spoiled brats. You ever seen a spoiled brat? Not going to ask any other questions on that one. But I've seen children in stores that, Mama, I want that. We're not getting it. I want that. And mom and dad go, okay, baby. Mama get it for him. Come here, mama, get it for him. Come here, just hold this. Hold it. Get right in the car. There you go. And you get down the next aisle. I want this. See, when you're not thank-filled, nothing's ever good enough. And a lot of times we are like that as adults and young people and so on and so forth. We get to the place where we're filled with all the wrong kinds of things, so we're not filled with the right kinds of things, so we don't live a thank-filled life. We get judgmental attitudes. We get, you know what, one of the things that shows up in people's lives that aren't thank-filled, harsh language and just mean-spirited things that they say, mean attitudes, dangerous thought patterns. I mean, folks, the list goes on and on and on and on and on for people that don't live thank-filled. We're moving this week towards a day that we call thanks what? Well, how can you thanksgive if you're not thank-filled? Because if you're trying to thanksgive and you're not thank-filled, the only thing you did, honey, was cook a turkey. I mean, have you really thought about it? We do stuff on autopilot so much that we don't even think about it anymore. Thanksgiving, what does it mean? Hey, we're going to put a turkey in the oven or a ham. I'm tired of turkey this year. We're going to get a ham. I'm tired of this. We're going to do this. No. You can't thanksgive. Do you remember what the first Thanksgiving was? Pilgrims and the Indians and the presentation of a turkey. I mean, it was a giving because they were thank-filled. Because their lives weren't going to be destroyed. We have been afforded the greatest, in my opinion, gift in all the world, and that is knowing Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. But we find ourselves falling into a life that becomes thankless, monotonous, joyless, and all those other kind of... But folks, if we would just be thankful. Not thankful for things. I saw people in Colombia that stood there and they were worshiping God, tears streaming down their face, and they pointed. I said, well, do these people live around the church? Do they live close by? And they said, they sure do. They live right over there in that alley of boxes. Right over there, you could see. They lived there, but they were some of the most exuberant worshipers. They were thank-filled. Their thankfulness to God, their worship to God was not based on any of the stuff that we'd base our life on in America. And you know what? You know what the difference was? The pastor and the congressman asked me, did I notice a notable difference between the service there and the service in America? Because they sang some of the same songs. They just did it in Spanish. And I said, I noticed one significant difference. He said, what's that? I said, the magnitude of the presence of God that's in the building. He said, why do you think that is? I said, because we're not thankful anymore. We've forgotten the reason we worship. And so what happens is instead of, can I just, give me just a couple more minutes. Can I just get real with you this morning? This is kind of, we live in a day and time where, I mean, my goodness, if someone doesn't call our name or phone call us or email us or Facebook us or celebrate us or do something we think we deserve, we leave the church over. We'll go find somewhere else to go. We'll go find something else to do. We'll talk about it. We'll be about it. We defriend people all the time. We estrange relationships all the time because someone said a bad thing to us or someone looked at us wrong or my family member didn't do this. Now I've alienated my brother or my sister or my mom didn't do this or my dad didn't do this. My uncle didn't do this. And we have had all this junk come to us because we're really not thank-filled. We're not thank-living. And you know what? You entertain that stuff when you're not thank-living too. These lepers come to Jesus and they had a problem. But only one of them returned. Nine were happy with going to the priest and going through all those rituals. They would take weeks, but one of them realized there's a change in my life and I'm thankful for that change. And he makes a beeline back to Jesus and the Bible says he was a Samaritan. Guess what? He was the least of all of them. The hated of all of them. He was an outcast before he was a leper. And he's the only one that comes back to Jesus and he says, Jesus, I just want to say thank you. And I want you to notice that the change of directive that comes. The nine, Jesus looks at them and says, go show yourself to the priest. But when the one returns, you see this language of Jesus change? He doesn't tell the one to go show himself to the priest. What does he say? He says, I see Jesus smile at him. He says, you go on your way. Your faith has made you whole or well. In other words, now let me give you this, because this is what I see in Scripture. I know I see Scripture strangely sometimes. The Bible says that he is our high priest forever. Okay? Now watch. Jesus tells the other ones that did not recognize him or be thankful for him, go show yourself to the earthly high priest. The one that returns in thanksgiving and with worship, he looks at him and says, go your way, your faith has made you whole. Well, wait a minute. Could there be something, John, about our worship and thanksgiving that elevate Jesus in our personal life to the place of high priest in our life so that he has the authority and the power to speak change into our lives so that we don't have to continue in the same old way that we get caught up in? There's something about thanksgiving that unlocks the virtue of our Lord Jesus Christ where he has the ability to speak into our lives the change that man cannot provide nor that man can give. And if we are going to be effective, and if we are going to make a difference for the kingdom of God, we've got to have a life that is filled with thanksgiving. Say thanksgiving. I know that's a tongue twister, because immediately at this time we want to go thanksgiving, thanksgiving giving, thanksgiving. But a life that is filled with thanksgiving, because here's what happens. When your life is filled with thanksgiving, you actually give Jesus the opportunity to speak change into your life so that out of your life, others' lives are changed. You won't hold a grudge as much as you do. You won't speak critically as much as you do. As a matter of fact, you'll have a gentle spirit. You'll have a giving attitude. You'll have a kind attitude. You'll have pure speech. You'll have a healthy thought pattern. All right, and I'm almost done. Husbands and wives, can I help you with something? All I need is one. Thank you. Praise God. I got one. That's all I needed. Wives, if your husband acts like an idiot and talks terrible to you and doesn't speak as though Christ would speak to his bride, I can tell you why. He's got a problem with thanksgiving. See, all the guys, y'all stop looking at me right there. That's all right. Get mad if you want to. Guys, can I help you? Oh, your wife's not in here. Somebody tell Vivian Richie said yes when a pastor asked that question. Guys, if your wife is always in a constant state of nag. Now look, you can't get mad on one side. You got to know it goes cuts both ways. The Bible's a double-edged sword. It don't just cut one way. It goes both ways. If your wife's a constant nag, you know why? I mean constant. Now, everybody has their moments, okay? Just don't stay there. But if it's just a constant vicious cycle all the time, they're struggling with thanksgiving. And somebody's got to shake somebody up and say, hey, wait a minute, we're not living and doing the way that God wants us and called us to live. How can we be an example of the Lord Jesus Christ if we're not living a life that is thankful? And if it's not thankful, you have nothing to give the world looking for Jesus. I want to challenge you with something. Play something soft for me. Next time you get around somebody and all they want to do is complain, stop them right in the middle of their tracks and say to them, do me a favor, tell me what you're grateful for. I mean, right smack in the middle of them, I don't like this. And they're just ranting and raving. Sometimes you slap them in the face. No, don't do that. Don't do that. Edit that video. I know we're recording that. Edit that part out. I can see somebody get that on the internet. The pastor said slap somebody in the face. But don't do that. That was a joke. Ha ha, okay? But next time you get around somebody, and all they want to do is be negative, ugly, critical, and complaining all the time. It's because, guess what? They're depleted from thanks of a life that is thankful. They're not thankful anymore. They've just turned into a bitter, upset individual. But you stop them and look at them and say, you know, just stop for a minute. Would you tell me what you're thankful for and why? Throw them a curveball. Make them swing. And if they start complaining again, stop them again. So that's not really what I asked you. I want to know what you're thankful for. Because here's what I've learned. You ever seen The Dog Whisperer? I like Cesar Millan. What's really neat with him is if he's got a dog that he's carrying with him, get down, come on, get down on your knees, do it, tell me no, he's got a, I really wouldn't fight me, son, come on, so he's got a dog, you see, that wasn't why, I'll drag you across the carpet, he tried to fight me, but here's the fun thing, Cesar Millan, when he's got a dog that's doing stuff he's not supposed to do, one of the neat things that Cesar, he says, you got to redirect him. You ever seen him redirect them? I love it. I do this to my wife. Playfully now, don't. I do it playfully. He'll walk out, dog. That dog's. And he'll go. He just hits him like. Did that hurt? I'm sorry. That didn't hurt. I get excited. He goes. Sometimes you see him take his foot and he go. And all of a sudden you see that dog. Just see what he did? You see that? As soon as I did that, he goes. And Cesar said that what he actually does is redirects the thought pattern so that he can build into them something healthy. Thank you. You did a fine job. Here's what happens. If you've got people in your life and they look like that, mean, ugly looking, all they do is negative stuff, Cesar Millan them with words. You have got to get their attention And you've got to say, tell me what you're thankful for. And when they start to revert back to the old behavior, tell me what you're thankful for. Now, I'm not going to let this mindset dominate my family. I'm not going to let this mindset dominate my church. I'm not going to let this dominate my friendships. Not going to let it dominate my workplace. I want to know, tell me what you're thankful for. Because I'm going to help retool you because you're valuable enough for me to retool. Now, you've got to do that. Don't expect the pastor to go run into everybody's homes and Caesar Milan everybody in your house. Okay? Not going to happen. Okay? That's why God's given you and me together the keys to the kingdom of God. So the next time that happens, help redirect your family, friends, and loved ones, and people in the church. If anyone ever tries to pull you into negative conversation, Caesar Milan them. And say, tell me what you're thankful for. We're not going to talk about that. Because you know what? At the end of the day, that's just foolishness you're spewing. And I really don't want to hear foolishness. Let's talk about what we're thankful for. Because God's been so good to us. Amen? Because watch this. You can't thanksgive unless you first thanks live. And if you try to thanksgive and don't have it living in you, it's just manipulation. Stand with me. I know I've given you a lot of stuff to think about today. Maybe I've made you mad. Maybe I've made you glad. Don't know. But I really believe that we perish as a people because we are blinded by the numbing of leprosy. We're numbed. We don't even know how bad it's really gotten because it's our talking point. Listen, negative is negative. I don't care how you slice it, dice it, or plate it. It's negative. Remember this. The Word of God says that out of the mouth or out of the power of the tongue comes life and death, blessing or cursing. Everybody, take your tongue out and look at it. No, don't do that. I'm just kidding. You have to guard your mind, your tongue, and what's filling in your heart, and because what's filling in it will ultimately come out. You cannot thanksgive unless you first thanks live. Amen? Father, thank you for your people today. Lord, I know that this is what you put on my heart for today. And I know that in many areas, we all fight this battle. And Lord, help us to retool our thinking, retool our minds, retool our mouths, and not get caught up in all the negativity, no matter how fun it might seem, no matter how great the talking point might be. But God, help us to not entertain it, because when we entertain it, it gives power to it, and when it gets power, it consumes. So help us, Lord, to be thanks-filled so that we can thanks-live, and as a result, we can be able to thanks-give. Father, thank you for this wonderful group of people. I'm truly grateful and thankful to you, God, for the wonderful folks at Healing Waters. I ask you, Lord, that you would cover every family this week as they make preparations, as meals are cooked, as families travel. I pray your traveling mercy upon them. And I just ask that you would cover your people, keep them safe, but help them to contemplate what they've heard today and be thanks-filled, so that that changes everything about who they are, so that you get the glory and that you can become actually the high priest that speaks through our lives every day. We give you glory for what you're going to do. Thank you for what you've already done. Bless your people, I pray, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. One last quick announcement. Wednesday night, there will not be service here. We know it's something we've done for the last 14 years. We encourage you to take that time. We know a lot of people do a lot of cooking, or a.k.a. burnt offerings on that night. But God bless you, and we'll see you back here next Sunday at our Partner Sunday. God bless you.